Yes, my viewer, it's on Wednesday, and it's my honor, it's my privilege to welcome you again today as we come to the end of our reflection with regard to significance of making disciples for Jesus. And yesterday, we were in the second stage. We were in the second stage, and we were talking of mature stage and the leader stage within Christian discipleship. As we go through this, I would like us to start with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you and we honor you and we glory in your goodness this morning. Lord, as we read your word, as we, Father Lord, resonate with it, we ask your Holy Spirit to minister to each and every one of us. We bless you, Lord, as we start with us. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. And so, friends, as I started by saying that yesterday, we were handling the second stage. That was the mature stage, or rather, the leader stage. And the life of Paul is still our focus. We are still focused on the lifestyle of Paul, the discipleship of Paul himself. Because, friends, remember what we were saying last week, that as we disciple people to Jesus, we should also know that we are disciples of the Lord himself. And so Paul's life gives us a lot of significance with regards to making disciples. And so the stage that I would like to bring now is the latter stage, or the legacy stage, which we are saying that Apostle Paul's discipleship journey in this kind of stage in his life would help us to actually draw a lot of significance with regards to making disciples for Jesus. We know that that at a latter stage, we are talking about a mature discipler. Paul is now a mature discipler. He's confident. He's gathered a lot of methods that he is employing in what he's doing. He's integrated a lot of methods in his lifestyle. And so it is a latter, very last stage that we are talking about. It is a stage that is marked with the legacy that one leaves, especially with regards to making disciples for the Lord. And you know, the process of discipleship, even as we look at the life of Apostle Paul, in his discipleship journey, you see he continues making disciples for the Lord throughout his lifetime. And so Paul got involved in making as many disciples for the Lord as possible. And there's a place that he coins a phrase and says that, follow me as I follow the Lord, as I follow Jesus Christ. And so we know that even in this very last stage of his life, even at this stage of legacy, we can still see him. We can still see him. And as we use the book of Acts, even through to Acts 28, you can still see and feel Paul in this very command, that Paul is still actively making disciples for the Lord. And yesterday, as we were coming to the end of what we were discussing, that the second stage, which we said that is a mature stage, or rather the leader stage, we were saying that it was very important also to listen and to follow the lead of God through the Holy Spirit of God, that we do a lot of listening to what the Spirit of God is telling us with regards to making disciples for the Lord. So in this stage of the third stage that we are talking about, look at the mission destination that Paul took, and you can see him very well that Paul, his mission destination was supposed to go until he gets back to Jerusalem. And as we read Acts chapter 19, you can see that Paul is actually into the lead of the Spirit of God, and he really knows how much he has to sprint to the end. And so in Acts chapter 19, already you can sense his spirit being so much connected to what God desires of him, even as he makes disciples, as he continues his mission on earth. Verses 21 says this: Now after these events, Paul resolved in the spirit to pass through Macedonia and Achaia and go to Jerusalem, saying, after I have been there, I must also see Rome. And so he knows that he has that missionary journey that is so clear in his spirit. And so we are saying that at this very last stage in the life of Paul, we can see very well that he is still composed to partake of all that God wants him, wants of him in his mission. And so as we read that even in chapter 23 and verses 11, we are still met with these very assuring words that shows us how much Paul was focused. You see, Paul made it to Rome, actually. So this is what he says, that the following night, the Lord stood by him and said, "Take courage, for as you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must bear witness also in Rome." And so you see, that is still clear in his mind. Still verses 14 through to 16, we are met with these words. And they went to the chief priest and elders and said, "We have strictly bound ourselves by an oath to taste no food till we have killed Paul." Remember, they're in Jerusalem. And so there's that thought that comes amongst the elders, and they go to the chief priest. So we know that this is the Jewish tradition. This is still in the Jewish tradition where the chief priest is there and the elders. And so we can see that there's a ploy already of wanting to kill Paul. He's in his legacy stage. He's in the latter stage of making disciples. And so we read this about his life. And so verses 15 says this, "You therefore, along with the council, give notice now to the tribune to bring him down to you as though you are going to determine his case more exactly, and we are ready to kill him before he comes near." And verse 16 says this, "Now the son of Paul's sister heard of their ambush, so he went and entered the barracks and told Paul." And so you can see, still through this kind of arrangement, Paul gets wind that he is supposed to be killed. The elders of the temple are planning this against him, and he's getting wind from one of his nephews. And verses 17, Paul, you see, Paul still demonstrates how significant discipleship is for a believer, because as you continue reading verses 17 even through to 22, you see his reaction. 17, "And Paul called one of the centurion and asked, 'Take this young man to the tribune, for he has something to tell him.' And so he organizes for that young man, the nephew, to go to the tribune to explain what he had heard about the ambush that these people were laying for him. So he took him, that centurion took this young man and brought him to the tribune and said, 'Paul the prisoner called me and asked me to bring this young man to you as he had something to say to you.' The tribune took him by the hand and, going aside, asked him privately what it is that you have to tell me. And he said, 'The Jews have agreed to ask you to bring Paul down to the council tomorrow, as though they were going to inquire somewhat more closely about him.'" And verses 21, "But do not yield to them, for more than 40 of their men lie in ambush for him, having bound themselves by an oath neither to eat nor drink till they have killed him. And now they are ready, waiting for the promise from you." So the tribune dismissed the young man, charging him, "Tell no one that you have informed me of this." And so we can see Paul yet made formal efforts. You see, he goes to the tribune and talks to the centurion, "Take this young man to the..." The protocol or the procedure that was supposed to be used against him, he uses the same procedure to reach out for more men to God. And we, as we read this, as he sorts the formal audience of that he be heard, you know, this explains his continuous mission journey. He's still writing his legacy. He's in that third stage. He is in the final lap, but still passionate about God. Go tell the Tribune, mean, about everything that you've heard. And so he tells his nephew, and this continues. We still see Paul, his enthusiasm in the work of God, in evangelizing. Paul, in his pursuit of making disciples for Christ, you see, he receives, and this helps us understand various responses in the messages that he writes, even in verse 24. The Tribune orders that Paul be provided security, you know, and he's given a ride, and he goes through to Governor Felix, and we see Paul go there, to Governor Felix. He continues making disciples for the Lord, even in his discussion communication with the elite, with the governor, and all these people. You know, the zeal of Paul of making disciples at this stage in his discipleship journey, you see, he's in this very final part, but he still seeks and gets audience to share about Christ, to speak about who Jesus is. Verses 25, you can read later, through even to verses 29. You see that a letter is written gives him even still that opportunity to continue his discipleship mission. And going through even to verse 30 to 31 of the same text, you realize that Paul, he gets both formal and informal stages stage of extending the mission of Christ. And this, friends, as we think through the significance of discipleship, I think this makes discipleship a lifestyle that involves us sharing the life of Jesus Christ, but also sharing our life so that we can give others faith. We share the life of Jesus, but we also share our own lives with others so that we can give them faith, because that is what makes discipleship significance. We share Jesus with them, but we also share our life, because at this stage, our life also speaks volume. Our life and what we have passed, what we have experienced with the Lord, would bring us many people to Him, even as we see in the life of Paul. You do this, as we do that, we try as much as we can to do that in a style that shows our genuine person and our genuine experience with the Lord. And I want to believe, as we narrate or as we tell people about Jesus, as we bring ourselves into the same experience, and as we bring others forth, we do this in a style that is so genuine that makes somebody else fall for Jesus, fall for the faith. And I want to believe then the third stage, in this case, that latter stage, that stage of legacy, makes it even authentic, that now genuinely somebody would look at our lives and know that, yes, this is a follower of Christ. What happened to Felix? What happened to the governor, even as he heard Jesus? As he heard Paul, by simply hearing him out, he would very fast know that this one wants to convert me, wants to make me a disciple of Jesus Christ. May the word of the Lord continues ministering to us as we dig deeper into Christian discipleship, and more so the significance of Christian discipleship in the life of a believer. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we honor you, we thank you, we adore you for all the stages that, Lord, a believer goes through as we seek many to be your disciples, and as we also get discipled, oh Father, Lord, for you. Lord, we pray that you will help us attain to these stages, giving glory to your holy name, giving glory as we begin, as we become leaders, and as we make legacy, as we finish up, Lord, our work, that, Lord, will not relent in any way, that we will continue the momentum even to the end. That is our prayer, Lord, as we go even into the rest of the day. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.